Hi, let's talk about the structure and function of the urinary system. In this video, we'll discuss the major structures and functions of the urinary system. We'll also discuss the gross features of the kidney. Now, when we think of the functions of the urinary system, we can think of what the kidneys do, aka the renal functions, versus what the ureters, the urinary bladder, and the urethra do. Here, in this video, we'll focus on the renal functions. Now, when we think of the physiology of the cardiovascular system, you know, we have materials coming in and out of metabolically active cells that are surrounded by interstitial fluid, and so there's an exchange of materials between these areas. We also have an exchange of materials in and out of the cardiovascular system, which is going to interplay with various other bodily systems. So the digestive system, the respiratory system, the urinary system. And it's the urinary system which is of particular interest to us here. The kidneys are amazing dynamic filters of the blood. And so we see how the kidneys are very important with respect to the maintenance of extracellular volume and osmolarity. So what we mean by that is all of the fluids which are not found within the cells, the kidneys are going to have some control over. Now, within that fluid are dissolved items that are very important to physiology, things like various ions, sodium, potassium, calcium, chloride, phosphate, etc. All of these things the kidneys can choose to either keep within the body or excrete as urine. Now, in the process of dynamically deciding whether or not we keep or excrete ions, the kidneys are going to have a profound impact on the maintenance of pH homeostasis. So in particular, in a region of the nephron called the distal convoluted tubule, there are opportunities to secrete protons or conserve, i.e. hold on to bicarbonate ions. And these are going to be very important in the context of carbonic acid bicarbonate ion buffer system for pH homeostasis in the blood. Also, extracellular fluid is predominantly water, and so the kidneys, in serving as dynamic filters, can decide how much water stays and how much water goes. And then finally, the kidneys are going to be able to impact glucose homeostasis. So there are two ways in which they may choose to do this, if we're to assign any teleological basis to this. One is through the process of gluconeogenesis. So the kidneys are able to build glucose through glutamine, or they can reabsorb glucose, which they typically do as part of their de facto processes. Or if levels of blood glucose are too high, they can even excrete it into the urine. The kidneys also serve an endocrine function. So there are three hormones that the kidneys secrete that are important to our body. So the first is calcitriol. Calcitriol is an activated form of vitamin D. It's secreted by cells of the proximal convoluted tubule, and it is an important cofactor for the absorption of calcium from the gut lumen. And so calcitriol has the impact of increasing plasma concentrations of calcium. There are also peritubular cells that are capable of secreting erythropoietin, or EPO. Erythropoietin, as you may recall from the cardiovascular lectures, is the hormone that's responsible for the initiation of erythropoiesis, or the creation of red blood cells. The kidneys also secrete renin. So there are juxtaglomerular cells as part of the juxtaglomerular apparatus nestled between the renal corpuscle and the distal convoluted tubule. And here, depending on conditions, we have a fantastic ability of intrinsically regulating renal processes, but we also have the ability of secreting renin, a hormone which is the beginning of the RAA pathway. RAA stands for renin angiotensin aldosterone, which is a pathway whose ultimate effect on the body is to increase blood pressure. And then finally, and probably most obvious among all of the renal functions, is the excretory role. So as part of serving as these dynamic filters, the kidneys are able to pull any of the wastes of catabolism away, any biologically active substances, drugs, etc., and excrete it as urine. Now, the basic anatomy of the urinary system is pretty simple. There are bilaterally paired, although not bilaterally symmetrical, kidneys. These kidneys are very well vascularized by renal arteries and veins, as we can see here. So they directly communicate through either the abdominal aorta or the inferior vena cava through these vessels. There are also, and this is a mistake, bilaterally paired ureters. These ureters transport urine produced by the kidneys down to the urinary bladder. And then not seen here is a midline tube called the urethra that drains the urinary bladder to the outside world. An individual kidney will have two borders and two poles. So there is a convex lateral border. That convex lateral border is directed posterolaterally. There is also a concave medial border. The concave medial border is directed anteromedially. And it's at that medial border that we have the hilum. So the hilum is the region which receives the neurovasculature as well as transmits the renal pelvis. So that hilum, once we pass that plane, goes into a renal sinus. So the renal sinus is the space that's surrounded by the parenchyma of the kidney. There are also superior poles and inferior poles to kidneys as well. And from time to time, there can be a special type of accessory renal arteries called polar arteries, which can be directed to either of these poles. So the hilum of the kidney is where everything enters or exits the kidney. There are a couple of major structures here to include. So renal arteries enter at the hilum. Here we can see the renal artery, and we can also see the renal plexus associated with that renal artery. So that's going in through the hilum as well. That renal artery is going to divide up into segmental arteries, which enter at the hilum. And from time to time, we may also see an accessory renal artery entering in the hilum, although we don't see that here. Renal veins also enter at the hilum. And the renal pelvis, which is contiguous with the ureter, is at the hilum as well. The physiologically active portion of the tissues of the kidney, or the parenchyma of the kidney, is divided into two types of tissue. There is cortex, and deep to the cortex, or surrounded by the cortex, medulla. So the medulla is organized into pyramids. It's probably a really poor choice of nomenclature here, because if you were to dissect away all of the cortex from the medulla, we would actually see that these are more cone-shaped than they are pyramidal. But when we look at them through dissected planes, they appear to be pyramids, and so that's what they're named. So the base of these pyramids is superficial, the apices are deep, and it's right at the apex of the pyramid that we have the renal papilla. The renal papilla is the point of no return for urine. So all throughout the cortex and medulla, blood is converted into filtrate, and then there's a process of secretion and reabsorption, so the movement of materials between the blood and the filtrate, and it's only at that renal papilla that there is no more exchange happening. So we can see how that renal papilla is surrounded here by this structure here, which is a minor calyx. Now the cortex, which surrounds the medulla, is organized in two regions. So there are cortical arches. Cortical arches are the regions of cortex that are superficial to the medulla. So all of these are cortical arches. And then there are renal columns. The columns are the spaces between the cortical arches and the pyramids. So I'm filling in the cortical columns here. And we'll see how nephrons, which are the functional units of kidneys, are going to be situated between both the cortex and the medulla. And that leads us to the assessment question of the video, and that is, which parts of the renal parenchyma are found between the pyramids? Is it the cortical arches? No, those are found superficial to the pyramids. Is it the medulla? Nope, those are the pyramids. Is it the papillae? Nope, the papillae are the apices of the pyramids. Correct answer, renal columns are found in between the pyramids. Thank you very much for your time.